is as easy to understand and easy to pick, really, for a lot of people who are in the field and a lot of people who maybe know others who, you know, are dealing with some issues or, you know, are confidants to people who might just, you know, a warning sign here or there or something that you heard today may help you pass on the information or tell them to go visit a doctor or do something to be able to help. So that's really the first of what I'm going to do today. And what we are going to do is that I'm going to speak about the medical aspects, and then Dr. Urvashi is going to speak about the psychological aspects, and then we'll open up the rest of the session for some questions and answers. However, I'd like to keep it interactive, and I'd like to go by kind of clues from what's coming from the audience and what you'd like also from me to handle. Can we just maybe go forward? So I think I'd like to start with something that was sad and obviously shakes us in our profession a lot. But this is a real case, and this case is of a boy called Arjun. I changed the name. And on April 3rd, 2017, Arjun, a 16-year-old management student, committed suicide by jumping out of the 19th floor hotel room. Media reporting suggested that he had been depressed about failure in exams and repeatedly talked about ending his life on social media. There were also rumors that he was battling drug addiction. Arjun's story made the headlines, likely because he killed himself at a five-star hotel and he had discussed suicide methods on Facebook, so it was already out there. But there are many such cases that go unreported. And as an aside, I just also want to mention, we had done a lecture series 2 or 3 months ago. We had talked about depression and suicide. And at the time, the National Crime Records Bureau, which keeps the records of any unnatural deaths, it had quoted that every hour one student commits suicide in India. So we're talking about the youth population, right? So we're really high up there. First of all, our population is very large, so we're likely to have a lot of people in that population. High population, welcome. In that population, we have a whole lot of youth. You know that our growing age group is in the youth range, and the maximum suicides are in this age group. So it's very concerning.
So I'm going to try not to be too repetitive. Last time in the IIC session, we had focused on depression and suicide. So this time, I would be focusing more on intervention for mania and hypomania. And as you rightly said, there's a lot of confusion about whether a psychologist really can do anything for people with mania and hypomania. Most of the evidence suggests that for mania, no, not much. But some studies show some promise in the area of hypomania. So today I'm going to talk about what we know about hypomania in teens, what are the psychological causes of bipolar disorder, assessment which can be done for teens who have bipolar disorder, focusing again on mania, psychological treatments of hypomania, and the challenge, not only hypomania, bipolar also, and the challenges that we face in diagnosis and treatment. Okay, so as Dr. Malika has already established, that bipolar disorder emerges in early childhood as well as adolescence also. And the clinical presentation of early onset bipolar disorder is very different from that of adults. In teens, as she already mentioned, that there is ADHD, there may be more irritability, more outbursts compared to adults. Initial symptoms, as she mentioned, are those of depression, following more irritability, aggression, or elation, etc. But there are again challenges in the diagnosis, because you also have to check whether these children or teens have experienced any trauma or abuse, because they do mimic symptoms which are similar to bipolar disorder, or if they have some emerging personality issues. So what new have we learned about teenage hypomania or mania till now? So we've found that their sensory profile is very different. It shows challenges in many areas. So by sensory profile, I'm talking about all the different sensory abilities that we have. So those are also slightly different compared to other people. And there is higher vestibular processing sensitivity. They get extremely tuned in to the environment compared to others, and they crave for sensory inputs, and once they go into their active mode, they become, you know, they're like stuck in it. And when they're anxious, again they do the same thing, they seek sensory experiences, and that can also include movement in space, like pacing around, wanting to go out in odd or unsafe hours, etc. And as they become more active, they crave sensations, and their sensory overload increases, and all this just escalates all of their problems. So this is like a cycle.